Forum webinar presented by Hindustan Times. Now, we're all aware of how newspapers in major cities like Mumbai had to stop printing for some time owing to the pandemic. Of course, the newspapers are back now. But what happened in the last few months did raise questions like whether the loyal reader will lose the long-cultivated habit of turning the pages of the good old newspaper and switch to other mediums instead. You know, have digital and TV benefited due to the lockdown? Are they getting more millennial attention today? And lastly, whether print will fight back? And that brings us to the topic of discussion today, the changing face of news and content consumption for millennials. The webinar is presented by Hindustan Times, and joining me are Anuja Mishra, VP and Head Marketing, Personal Care and Hygiene at Godrej Consumer Products Limited. Hi, Anuja.
Hi, Neeta.
We have Anil Vishwanathan, Director Marketing Chocolates at Mondelez India.
Anita.
Hi, Anil. We also have Rana Barua, Group CEO of Havas Group India.
Anita.
Hi, Rana, how are you?
Good. Good to see you, Anita. Hi.
And we have Vikram Sakuja, Group CEO and OH Madison World. Hi,
Anita.
Vikram.
Good to see you.
And lastly, we have Rajan Bhalla, Group CMO, HT Media Limited, and Rajiv Biotra, Executive Director, Revenue, HT Media Limited. Hi, Rajiv. Hi,
hi,
Rajan.
Hi, everybody. Hi, Neeta.
Good to see all of you.
So a big welcome to all of you and also to everyone who's watching. Do send us any questions that you may have, and our panelists shall be very happy to address it through the course of the discussion, maybe towards the end. So let me start with you, Rajan. You know, I remember seeing this ad by HT during lockdown. You know, it literally said the paper itself is safe. All plants are fumigated and sanitized. Now, this was a time when people were either not getting newspapers or were afraid to touch it. Now, so for all those physical, hardcore newspaper readers out there like you, has much changed in the lockdown?
Well, you know, I think lockdown can also be broken into phases, just as unlocking is kind of being broken into phases. I think the first phase of lockdown, which is really around April, May thereabouts, a lot of people just didn't know what was happening and they were not very sure. I mean, obviously, the whole piece of pandemic, which we are now kind of getting used to and living along with, was not the case at that time. And there was a lot of uncertainty on various counts. Very clearly, the newspaper distribution got impacted. Very clearly that there were myths about newspaper being a carrier of virus, which it definitely isn't. And, you know, I think both us and TOI and the industry per se tried their best to educate consumers that, you know, this is not a surface that can actually transmit any virus, and therefore you don't need to be worried about it at all. And we had also taken a lot of steps of fumigation plants, our supply chain, et cetera, et cetera. But obviously some consumers and RWAs were okay with newspapers coming in, some were not. And for those who were not, obviously digital was the next medium they would resort to, because not having to read news in the morning, at least for some of us, is a big challenge. So, you know, you have to reach out and get your news. So the PDFs started floating around, which was illegal. And there were different sources which kind of gave PDFs of all the various brands that you could think of, including international brands that people started getting. But I think in due course, a lot of them started switching to e-papers. But I'm very happy to say that, you know, now where we are today, I think in the heartland of vernaculars, we are back to almost about 90% distribution, which is absolutely phenomenal. And we are also seeing a very, very strong pickup coming back in the metros, of which Delhi is really leading the pack and doing the best at the moment. Yeah.
Let me come to you, Mr. Sakuja, now. You know, how exactly are the millennials consuming news and content today after the pandemic struck? You know, literally news, TV news viewership is at an all-time high. Especially, I think, you know, it's pretty much gone up from 7 to 21%, at least in the initial months it did. So tell me, how has it been?
Okay, it's like this. Before the pandemic, if you have to look at overall news and content consumption, I would say that, look, I'm relying my base on all India basis, and then we can cut down to metros and stuff like that. It's pretty much clear that whether it is news or whether it is content, TV is actually the ruling medium where most numbers actually come in to consume in terms of reach, and even the time spent is coming most on TV. Now, when it comes to news, I would still say in terms of pure numbers, print would come in second, followed by digital. And I hear there's a slight qualifier. Data sources in digital are unfortunately very, they're murky and they're not very precise. So if I looked at two data sources, one told me that during June, July, it had actually crossed, digital had crossed what print is readership is all about online for news. And I was taking key titles and viewing their readership on IRS as well as the print through whatever. I was looking at Comscore and similar web. Now, one data source told me it was equal to print. Another data source told me it was 25% of print. So there is a big, so even in the kind of reporting of readership online, I think there is a little bit left to be desired to make it truly authentic. But I would say number one, TV, news at the moment, print is number two, digital is number three in catching up. And on the content side, right now, OTTs and whatever else you have is a distant number two to TV at this point in time, also catching up.
Mr. Barua, would you like to tell us, you know, to what extent have the breaks in the physical delivery of print media propelled the shift to digital?
I think, you know, if I just take, you know, what Vikram is saying, and if I to just take this point forward, I think, you know, it is a habit that was emerging even pre-COVID. So while I'm not getting into the figures and what's coming out, you know, pre-COVID or what's happened now, I think there was a bit of a shift that was happening to the news as a pattern. And I'm talking about a bit of a link with the millennial behavior and how they were interacting. But there's been a shift towards, you know, consumption and the way we were consuming a lot of news, because, you know, news is dynamic. And the only big glaring example I think we are all discussing and which is becoming a very critical issue is the reason why print, I think, sometimes still scores is because naturally is the genuinity and the entire genuine news that you get versus a so much of fake and scam that is happening in the online media, which we've all been exposed to in the last 4 months, especially during lockdown. So I think, you know, if I take it as a habit consumption pattern, I think, you know, we are naturally going to see a shift in terms of online consumption, the way we are going to consume news, whether it's in terms of quick news, whether it's in going to consume news, which is, you know, there are, you know, the generations which are awake through the night, they're picking up news. You know, when, you know, recently when one of the very big celebrities of Hollywood died, there were people who actually saw the news at 6 a.m. in the morning because that's how fresh it was. It came out at that hour. And that's how the world got to know. By 7 a.m., everybody in India knew that, you know, there was this celebrity who had passed away. But the point is that, you know, with that, you also start questioning, is it true news? Is it fake? Because I remember many, many, many questions were going down the round. Is this true? Is this honest? Has he passed away? I think we need to be very clear that there is a difference between behavior consumption and there's a difference between what we are reading is as two different habits.
Mm-hmm. That's good news for you, Mr. Bhalla. I mean, of course, the credibility part of it is supreme. People, they, you know, pick up that newspaper because they are sure that this news is true and valid. But, you know, in the past few months, you know, the hard copies of newspapers had, you know, had seen lesser pages. Of course, the lack of advertisements were also evident in April, May and June period. But recently we saw some regional newspapers, you know, release 50 page editions with a lot of advertisements. Can one say newspapers are slowly inching back towards pre-levered COVID business? Or is it too soon to say that? Mr. Biotra, would you like to take that? The revenue expert.
No, I'm far from being an expert, so I'll only talk data. So yeah, it has been a sequential improvement. And I would say that languages have possibly seen a better resilience overall than compared to English. And in languages, I would say the industry is actually now already August month already operating at almost 80% of last year volumes. Now I don't have exact data. Vikram will possibly be a better expert, but I'm suspecting that most medium, including television and even digital mediums are operating possibly in the same vicinity of volumes compared to last year, I'm assuming. So I would say print is also possibly keeping pace in terms of having arrived at a certain level compared to last year in terms of volumes. So we are pleased with what we have seen so far, and I think festive. And you're right, some of the publications did have, actually most of us on different days have had some good days in the last month or two.
So bulky editions hopefully will be back soon.
yeah, already looking at 70-80% of last year volumes are already there. So we are hoping that things will come back to some semblance of last year level soon.
Okay. Now I'd like to bring in our brand marketers in here. Mr. Vishwanathan, would you say advertising monies are shifting at a very quick pace towards digital, or print is still out there strong?
I think, Neeta, what's happening, as Vikram has clarified already, I think at a broad level, consumption has gone up across media, given that people are at home and consuming all kinds of content. I think what you observed is that consumption has gone up across, predominantly television and digital, for the very reasons that we've been speaking about, at least in the early parts. And that has kind of sustained. It's been up and down across different time, day parts, et cetera, et cetera. I think at a broad level, overall consumption has gone up across media. So in that context, for most brand marketers, we go where the consumers are, and we're guided by, at a very broad level, from a reach standpoint, by the kind of number that we are tracking and all the industry benchmarks that's coming through. So I don't think we're making significant changes in that context per se in terms of priority of media. But I think at a fundamental level, at least for some consumer cohorts, Neeta, the other element that I want to bring in is, one is consumption of content and the other is engagement with the content. And when I look at engagement, and in the context especially of millennials, we do find that there are some media where engagement is far more enabled and possible. And that's resulting in them spending more time, them having a better quality of engagement, and that's also validated through the responses we get to our activations. So it's kind of a hybrid situation where they might be consuming content somewhere and then coming somewhere else to engage with it. And that, I think that element of engagement is important. What we are seeing specifically for the millennials, kind of a digital first, I think the two things that dramatically change is an ability for a brand or anybody to speak to me on a one-on-one basis, and the ability for me to engage back or give my feedback. I think these two changes, which is not kind of existed in the classical situation, is one-to-many kind of a broadcast kind of a method in the past. I think this is resulting in a significant change in the way millennials are engaging with content. And I think that's the other bit that comes into consideration as we think about putting in our media monies. So I think as we're building up our plans beyond reach, I think engagement then becomes a big driver. And there, definitely are seeing shifts, specifically the kind of time spent amongst the younger consumer cohorts on digital is definitely influencing spending, especially those brands which are catering to those urban millennials.
Okay. Did it also happen to you, Ms. Mishra, wherein you had advertising money which would otherwise go to print, but now you're pumping it into digital? As per, like Mr. Sakuja can back me, I think the print Pitch Madison report said that in Q1, print ad volumes degrew by about 79%. So is that something that your brand has also looked at? And
Neeta, I think it's been a function of course many variables and many factors. To sort of answer your question very sharply, I think the first quarter, which was also really sort of the sort of setting up of the pandemic, definitely the print advertising did go down. And Rajiv also spoke about that immediate sort of cutting down of newspapers across RWAs and so on. That was pretty much a very uncertain period, I think, as much for marketers. That's also peak season for many categories, as you're sort of setting into summers, particularly for the soaps categories and so on. So I think definitely, TV, which has always been a larger chunk of where the money has been, sort of certainly reserved that chunk. But of course, digital did benefit in that quarter, I'd say. Specifically where I think, the need of the brand was to talk to the consumer with a far higher lens of empathy and connecting, you know, to the, let's say, needs of the consumer during COVID. So case in point, let's say, being, you know, particularly in hygiene categories, right, where there was this sudden flux of advertising monies, you know, way higher than, let's say, what we would have seen over the last couple of years. What was really also important, you know, and kind of completely agree with Anil on that point, you know, it's very important to be then not just looking at reach, but, you know, as much building authenticity, you know, as much giving, you know, the consumer the chance of interaction, hearing them out, you know, while you talk to them. And I think in that perspective, I think digital has clearly seen an acceleration, I'd say, over the last 3 to 4 months. I'm sure the jury is still out, right, in terms of which is going to be the reigning medium for news or content and so on. But I think digital has definitely seen a, you know, flurry of acceleration over the last now couple of quarters. And I think that was very evident, though, you know, though I sort of again, you know, sort of put a few disclaimers around it. It's really sort of, you know, upon the brand and the role of the brand and so on. But keeping very particularly to that quarter, I think the print spends definitely, if I was to compare it to last year same time, did sort of see a little bit of a pinch there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, we spoke about the, you know, the advertisement part of it. I'd like to talk about readership. Mr. Sakuja, you kind of touched upon it. I'd like to come back to you. You know, India has for years defied the global trend of print media losing readership. Do you think the pandemic is going to change that for us?
Not profoundly. So starting point, again, backing up a bit, what you're going to see is multimedia consumption and more of it. Okay. India is a very heterogeneous market. So I would wager that about, on average, an average Indian who's exposed to any of the mediums is consuming maybe about up to 5 hours perhaps on average in a day.
Okay.
To the higher end of the entire average into the range, the metro NCCSA kind of young millennials at that, they may go as high as even 9 or 10 hours.
Okay.
But if I have to look at US, when I was doing a global job, I was looking at it, and then at that time we saw that it went up for even markets like the US, which had 12 hours of media consumption, went up upwards of 13. And obviously we are talking about people are using mediums concomitantly together. So there's multiple, you're watching TV with your mobile and all that. So I think what we're going to be seeing is more consumption of various mediums before you start seeing actually some completely dropping off. That said, print, what we've seen is there has been a gradual decline in readership over the years.
Mm-hmm.
I say gradual. Total readership that is reading at a 1 month level has not really gone down that much. We have about 400 million of the 110 crores that is actually measured is actually reading right now. More than 40 crores are reading a paper once in a month. But if you have to look at the read in the last 1 day, that's what we call average issue readership, that has slipped a little bit from about 17% of all has gone down to maybe about 14-15% of all. The important point out here is the millennials, which is really early 20s to late 30s, they are against an average issue readership of maybe 15 average, they're at about 13. So they are not that much lower.
Okay.
Where you're actually seeing the decline is in Gen Z, the people who are right now teenagers.
Okay.
So I'm expecting in print, it is going to be a gradual decline. And then it may be a precipice when a new generation, which was not sort of weaned off newspapers or having them right now, if they suddenly stop, you'll suddenly see a sharp drop. But nothing for the next, I think next 5 to 8 years, you'll see a gradual decline.
I'd like to come to Gen Z, but before that, I'd quickly like to ask Mr. Barua, you know, we've seen several newspapers shut down in this period, but on the positive side, like Mr. Biotra said, you know, they're trying to bounce back. Bulky editions are expected to be back soon. But in this brief time, you know, during the pandemic, when there was a problem with newspaper availability, you know, there was a habit that was formed. People had switched to e-papers. Now, of course, newspapers are coming back to its former glory slowly. But do you think, you know, e-paper is going to work just fine for them? I mean, it's all about creating that habit, right?
Yeah, so like I said, you know, I think, you know, like, you know, even in my initial answer, I said that, you know, this is a clear habit and, you know, it's not about whether print is going to go down. Of course, the numbers will come down, but print through digital is here to stay. And it's a given that, you know, the, you know, I will still read and, you know, the kind of medium that we are talking, whether it's the millennial, and I completely agree with Vikram, it's the Gen Z where the problem will be. That's a separate conversation. But if I look at the current generation and the way they're adopting to the medium, it will be, you know, so today when print is back, there is enough and more numbers which is showing, and we've got enough and more clients to back that entire thing to say that the first thing they wanted to know is that, can we go back into the print medium? Can I get that particular page that I used to take? Can I get back my weekend thing? So the interest is back, and there are certain categories and certain segments and certain clients who will stick to print, you know, come what may. Now, when I get back to the content that you're talking about and how I consume the content, there will be the entire population, there will be clear divide between the people, you know, who would wait for the print to come in, like people like me. And there are many I know who, you know, at 6:30, if the print is not at home, and I congratulate both Rajiv and Rajan for the fabulous HD, which has come out, you know, in the beginning of this week, which looks so, so dynamic. You want to read it. But then when you start consuming the content into the new habit, if you call it, or the way we are reading the e-paper, there's the mint, which you consume through your newspapers. You're consuming a lot of these through the entire habit. So it's now getting into a habit of reading the print, which is in the hard version. And you're also reading because there's a lot of news which is happening late at night, you know, so there is stuff that's coming up in their portals, which you can see, okay, what's the count of coronavirus? What happened, you know, is what happened post the budgeting thing? What happened post the GDP going down? You look at 10:30 p.m., you'll have something updated on Mint in the last 2 minutes. Now that's something you pick it up then. When you want to read it properly, maybe you see it in the morning. So, you know, it's going to be a mix of both with, you know, but like I said, the content has to be different for both the formats.
Mr. Bhalla, let me now ask you, you know, how are legacy print players reinventing themselves to fit in the current scheme of things? Like Mr. Barua mentioned, you just relaunched your flagship publication, Hindustan Times. Tell us more about how you're going about it.
Well, you know, as I said, Neeta, I have a very short presentation also that I can share with the group and the people around. But really, you know, a lot of what I'm going to say in the presentation, a synopsis of that is that fundamentally, it's really about getting into the skin of the millennial consumer. And that's what we have been doing very, very rigorously. Not that it only started a year back, but this specific project we started working on about a year back. And I think I so resonate with what Rana just said. Print is not a medium for breaking news. Okay, that is not what this is. And it can't be, right? Because the world is now one single place, things happen at night, and you know, it's whenever it happens, and you put your newspaper to bed every day around 11 o'clock, what happens after that is all stuff that people don't. And I think that aspect very clearly said, and what Vikram said earlier, that multimedia consumption by millennials is the order. Got us to think how we integrate the print and the digital platforms in a manner that the consumption habit of even the print changes very drastically over a period of time. And I'll explain that of how we did. And the other thing that it led us to is our new positioning, which actually puts a lot of pressure back on us, which is, first voice, last word. First voice alludes to the digital news, alludes to breaking stories, alludes to bringing the relevant news to consumers first. And the last voice actually is about the credibility of the platforms, be it digital or be it print, where you know the journalistic values and journalistic credibility comes into play. So those are really the tenets of how we went about it, but would be happy to share it with the group.
Now, that's actually quite interesting. First voice and last word. Nice. Mr. Biotra, I'd like to ask you, on one side, you have millennials who are perhaps hooked to the new age news platforms like the Quint, the Wire, who are literally built on that millennial mindset. On the other hand, you have the middle-aged or the elderly population who post converts to digital because of the situation. Now, who are you targeting through your new position, and which of the two will be easier to get on board?
Actually, this is more Rajan's, but look, the unique thing about our product is that we have to design. That's the dilemma that most editors are always confronted with. They have to design and create this product which appeals to all kinds of cohorts. So while we have done a lot of research, certainly done, as Rajan mentioned, a lot of research to, and Vikram mentioned earlier, nothing wrong with the readership percentages of the millennials as well, as far as newspapers are concerned. So we have taken extra effort to make sure that we are a little more appealing to them, but at the same time, we have to pander to the needs of our loyal readers as well. So I would say we are for all. Rajan, do you want to add to this? I'll leave it to you.
No, I think I would rather say something on your behalf. I think what is also happening, this is one side, which is the consumer. There is another side, which is the customer. Even customers, I would reckon, whether it is Anil here, Anuja, all of those are also looking at integrated platforms and integrated solutions now. It's not about just going to one medium and trying to do something. It's about how you can actually play out your message in a manner that you maximize your reach. You maximize your engagement, because today's consumer is a consumer who wants to get into a dialogue with the brand and therefore create the right impact. So I think, what we are really very excited about, and I think Rajiv now leads the organization on print with digital, all of those solutions, which are integrated solutions for the customers and not just about print and all of that. I think that's also a big change that we want to drive in the industry as we go forward.
I'd like to ask Mr. Vishwanathan and Ms. Mishra, what does an integration like this mean for a brand like yours?
I think integration in many ways allows us to create the kind of desired impact, as Rajan said. And I think best served explaining through an example. And I think more recently we had this interesting initiative that we put out through the COVID times, which was the Thank You initiative with Cadbury Dairy Milk. So, as part of the entire campaign, the heart of it was the Thank You bar that we had created in 8 different languages that we sold on retail, kind of a telegraphic method to land an idea about expressing gratitude and acknowledging and creating a sense of connection with others. And then we amplified that through television comms. We amplified that through a partnership with the Sun Times. We amplified that through a partnership with Jio and digital. And then what we did was then what was right for the medium to ensure that message lands. So while we crafted with the help of our agency partners a very nice set of pieces of content on television, where print came handy was to say that, this is not an idea to sell more chocolate, but also to kind of drive a broader thought about acknowledging the unacknowledged. And how do we create awareness of this initiative in a more credible fashion is where print came in, where, we picked up stories, the real life stories of people who are going about doing their bit at times like this, at times of crisis like this, and going beyond their call of duty to do something. Not for any recognition or not for want of anything in return, but purely because they felt that they needed to do it. And, what the brand did in partnership was to, acknowledge these people. So I think, again, print then allows us to drive credibility on a thought that we think, the brand has a point of view, not just about communicating through interesting storytelling, but also bring it to life in a credible fashion, which we were able to do through print. And then to close the loop with a Generation Zer who possibly doesn't have so much of patience to read through an emotional story, get him engaged on Jio so that he's there on Jio and he takes a Jio pledge where he says thank you to somebody else and that other person gets something as an acknowledgement. So I think that's what an integration allows you to do, kind of elevate and create the impact for an idea. Otherwise, it tends to get restricted to building awareness of the idea, but then doesn't allow the consumer to experience it in the fullest of fashion. And of course, for a brand like Cadbury Dairy Milk, you're also talking about a universal target. And hence, it's important that we're able to get people at different parts of the consumer journey at different points. And that's what an integration again allows us to do.
So it actually does make sense for a brand like yours, a mass brand like yours. You know, you can get the elderly population on one medium and, you know, you can get the millennials on the other. And that's a win-win.
Yeah, or the same across multiple ones. It's very difficult to drive behavior. I mean, it's easy to drive awareness, but go right down through, down the funnel is also very difficult, right? I mean, that's the kind of the holy grail that we're all chasing. If you're able to achieve that, it's great. And I think that's where it's also getting phenomenally complex, right? You don't know where to catch whom. So I think that's where the integration helps.
What about you, Ms. Mishra? What kind of boxes should it tick for you?
So honestly, Neeta, it always has been and will continue to be a brand task. I don't think any marketer wakes up in the morning saying, let me do some digital today or let me do some print today. I think it pretty much starts with what is the objective of my brand. I think just again illustrating this, a very recent example with the entire pandemic breaking out. At GCPL, we launched, a master hygiene trademark under Protect, where we launched almost about 12 to 14 hygiene categories. And by doing that, the task was not any one or two, where I could sort of, with my convenience, just choose one medium and say, this medium ticks the boxes on everything. I think in that sense, marketing always has that conventional wisdom, right? Where you do need reach, you do need engagement, you do have now a role of the influencers, but you also have the role of, again, building that whole genuineness, credibility behind your brand. We also have the traditional task of, just announcing that here is this complete range that's here to sort of protect your family. And, interestingly, as much as we talk about digital and as much as I think I would be talking about, let's say, digital really catching up and so on, it's very interesting that when you actually start to put your tasks down on paper, you realize that the fundamental role of each medium still pretty much holds true. What may have changed a little temporarily is that, maybe the numbers have sort of moved up and down, but like, let me sort of accent the word temporarily. For us, what was really important is that we're talking to the consumers contextually at the point of usage, let's say, which happens through digital. I have a certain storytelling to do about my brand, which is best done, let's say, through, television. But when it comes to print, and the kind of credibility it gives and the kind of, I think, stay I get, beyond a 30 and a 60 second and a 15 second, and just the ability to, let's say, absorb the consumer's energy and attention is, I think, still its biggest asset. So I think in that sense, the way we would look at any medium, wouldn't really sort of change. Each medium needs to sort of rise to the occasion, and sort of essentially, present its credibility and its, merit to be chosen eventually.
Mr. Barua, there was always this sizable difference in ad spots between the digital medium and the traditional media. Right now, do you see that gap getting bridged, considering digital has come in the spotlight now? It's not just a secondary medium post the lockdown.
So this again is just a lockdown. It's been just for the lockdown time. There has been a bit of spurt that we see, but if you saw the initial part when Vikram started the presentation with numbers and all, I think it's very clear that TV is naturally, way ahead of the curve. And also because, what we just discussed, we have two very clear marketers who are talking about how to choose the medium. So for example, this is, if I'm choosing my target audience and I know exactly what I'm going to do, television will continue to play a role which will be about storytelling, which will be of higher engagement, which will be about a certain, efficacy medium, because I'll be able to reach out to a much wider audience, much, much wider audience. You've seen the excitement, what a event like IPL is generating, which is beyond all the issues and other controversies that we hear. But the moment we hear that IPL is back, we've had just too much of interest from most of our clients to say, can we get up? Can we, is there an opportunity? What can we do? We don't get that kind of excitement that you get from any other medium, which is, first and foremost television. So I think what happened over the last quarter was more about, the purse strings had to be held on. A lot of marketers had to be absolutely sensible because naturally it was a complete lockdown. And even when the lockdown started opening partially, you didn't know what was going on, whether I could actually, why would I spend, what would I do? So I would continue to engage with the consumers through a medium which was cost effective, which would allow me to talk, which would allow me to keep communicating, because going out of a consumer's mindset is also harakiri. You know, it's something which comes from our group, which is called the Meaningful Brand Study. It is amazing that, you know, if you are not continuing to have a purpose or a meaning in the consumer's mindset, the consumers tend to, you know how we are, we forget, you know, what that role of that brand is. So I think digital played that little bit of a makeshift or a pattern where it did. And then now finally, you know, hopefully if things start improving and we start seeing a better opening up and, you know, a bit more sensibility about the lockdowns and a bit more clarity about how we behave, I think you will find digital playing the role profile that it was doing earlier. And like, you know, because we'll be consuming multimediums, you'll have print playing a very strong role, continuing to roll with a combination of print and online, and digital will be playing a bit more of a, you know, different profile, maybe to, like we said, a younger audience, which is engaging in a different way. And television will continue to drive the medium for the brands which need to have a conversation and story which needs to be told.
Interesting. Mrs. Akhuja, you know, with legacy players like Hindustan Times, you know, entering untrespassed lands and, you know, through this kind of a novel integration between print and digital, what do you think it will be like? Will it be advantage new age media platforms who have always been digital, or will it be legacy media news organizations, you know, who have the credibility and are fast adapting to digital?
You put an either or question to me. So, no, I'd say that at this point in time, if there are legacy organization, media organizations, versus just standalone online new age kind of publishers, I think the legacy ones have they have an advantage at this point in time. They have an opportunity, I should put it that way. The opportunity right now is, I think we've spoken enough to say that different mediums have different roles. I think very nicely put by HT themselves, if they say this in the first voice, last word, there is a medium for the first voice, there is a medium for the last word. Now in this, I've done a plug for you, Rajan, one drink. So now after that, but jokes aside, the fact remains that I think the legacy media organizations, if they are agile and if they're able to actually straddle both spaces, they can actually have a much better job than somebody who's only doing, say, an online publishing job. The part which, I mean, I'm just moving this conversation into, they have an opportunity to actually, from a monetizing standpoint, sell both. So you can sell online as well as they can sell the legacy medium. So like Anil was talking about, different mediums have different roles from an integration standpoint. Something's about awareness, something's about engagement, something's about authenticity, credibility, all the rest of it. You can actually put different options that you've got available to you to the advertiser and say, I'm a one-stop that at least does most of them. This, however, requires a fair amount of rejigging of your ad sales teams. I don't know whether they're trained enough to right now sell the two mediums. I don't even think so. You know, those things come in. I think there's this entire piece about media equivalence and of a cost per thousand has got to be seen on online versus print versus TV. What should be the terms of those equivalents? There is also that entire piece of, should I buy the inventory programmatically much cheaper from a platform, or should I be buying it at a premium from a publisher?
Right.
So I think this opens up the entire, maybe Pandora's box, but I think it's an exciting Pandora's box about what a legacy player can actually do to tap both their assets.
You know, and I guess maybe just butting in to say that, in many ways, it's quite similar to any industry. We talk about large existing legacy brands and insurgent brands. And you know, the conversation is quite common everywhere, right? And I think specifically at times like this, and kudos to HT to have chosen the relaunch at this kind of a time, because at this time, consumers are looking for all data series. They are looking for brands that they can trust. They want to engage and want reassurances from large brands. So I think in that sense, you know, they're very well placed by leveraging the situation per se, but fundamentally there is a whole infrastructure, there is the whole legacy over a period of time that they can leverage, and agility is what is required, and I think they're demonstrating that.
Fabulous. No, I think this is a time where we should get a sneak peek into what HT is actually doing with their new positioning, first voice and last word. So Rajan, over to you.
Yeah, usually, you know, brand and your own presentations tend to get very boring. I'll try to make it interesting and very, very short. And I think look at it more from the point of view of consumer insighting and how we leverage those insights versus a story on what this new product is all about. So let me just put it in that context and share it with you very quickly. And then probably we can play out the... Anuja said something which is very close to my heart as well, which is the whole aspect of genuineness and credibility that you need to build around the brand. And I think our film actually is only focused on building that out for Hindustan Times. So very happy to share that with everybody here. Okay, will you put it up? So let me just start with, saying that this whole project actually took us about a year of very deep consumer work. I think the first 6 months actually went into consumer insighting, both qualitative and quantitative, understanding the millennial consumers about what they wanted, what were the gaps, what were the need gaps in consumption of news and content in general, and equally going into the older segment to make sure that we understand their current needs as well and do not alienate them as we build out the new proposition. I think the second thing was about this whole piece of bringing credibility and legacy, because, you know, we are a legacy company. We started in 1924, and the entire story from the quill to the cursor is what we wanted to bring out and put out our values of clarity and credibility. All of that had to be translated into a brand refresh, which actually brings the old, which is the legacy aspect, and yet looks very contemporary. And that's what this new logo was all about. And then obviously came the positioning, which was about saying that this is a brand which stands for a certain set of values and agnostic of the platform. So you could be on digital, you could be on print. The core values remain the same. But digital lends the first voice to it, and the last word is where the printed word makes all the difference. So that's really the little story of how we went about doing it. Go ahead. Or can I do it from here? No, I can't seem to be. Yeah, keep moving. Go to the next one, please. Keep it short as I promised. Go to the next one. For many of you who do not know about this, but we started the company, or Hindustan Times was launched in 1924, September of 1924. And Mahatma Gandhi himself launched the brand at that time. And I think the core values that we built at the time of the launch are something that we cherish, which are around clarity and credibility. And that's what we carry through. Irrespective of how the generations have moved or how the periods have moved or how the competition has moved, you can't move away from your core. Keep going. Again, there is a very interesting book we have put together which really talks about the different decades and how Hindustan Times has been right in the center of the various events that have happened across the world. And how Hindustan Times has actually been a harbinger of change, transition and progress during this period. So I won't spend time on each decade, but should you be interested in looking at the book, just let us know. We'll figure out a way to get it to you. Okay, go forward. Yeah, so different decades, different eras, different events. Keep going, please. I think we've talked enough about the millennials. I'll skip this slide, but I'll go to the next one. So I think when it comes to the millennials, I think in today's world, one of the pieces which is very important is the fact that there is so much of clutter. There is so much of news that you're not sure of. I think Rana mentioned about the news that he got, and he said, I wasn't sure whether it is true. And I think in this whole aspect of fake news, lack of credibility of what you hear, sensationalism, you definitely need mediums which are valid or trustable mediums for breaking news, equally the printed word for credibility and the knowledge aspect of it. And I think those two have to come together. And this is not me saying that. This is actually what we picked up out of the millennials. Go forward. Whole lot of different need states. And I think somebody again in the webinar talked about positive news. I think very important, very much picked up as our inciting process went through. I think health and wellness, we all know, is a huge area. How would the post-lockdown lifestyle change? Technology, auto, my passion, travel, et cetera, personal finance. With all this happening, how am I going to manage my life, my future? How is the future of education going to change? So all of these are some of the aspects which kind of, you know, brought us to look at content, which I would call news I can use. Keep going. I've already spoken about this. Keep going. You can keep moving forward. So, you know, that brought us all finally to this positioning, which is first voice, last word. And while I'll show you a film, here is what our manifesto said. The truth needs to be voiced unapologetically, without any prejudices. The truth needs to be voiced carefully, without twisting the facts. The truth needs to be voiced transparently, like a mirror that portrays, well, a true image. The truth needs to be voiced daily, on every medium, every time, because only when you voice the truth can the voice cut through all the noise. Hindustan Times, first voice, last word. That's really the manifesto that we put out to be very clear about how the brand's core is going to operate in different ways. Keep going. Keep going, please. Next. So here is the new paper for many of you who haven't seen. And, you know, I'm going to explain this whole print digital interface on this slide, and I'm going to repeat that again. Really, the starting point for us was how do we get people engaged with the newspaper as opposed to just reading it passively? And also, given the fact that there is the digital medium which is picking up on news consumption pretty fast, how do we kind of bring the two together? I must, at this point in time, acknowledge a person called Mario Garcia, who is one of the leading newspaper web designers in the world. This, if I'm not mistaken, is his 781st project across the globe, almost 800 projects he's done. And we roped him in, and fortunately, before the pandemic, he was able to join us in January. And we started with actually, you know, challenging all orthodoxies, trying to bring in discontinuities that are going to change the way print medium is seen. So I've already spoken about the masthead and all of that. What you see on the top left, just below the masthead, is what we call a social card. Now, social card is nothing but a very simple way when it comes to a print form. There are people love to click something and share. But when they want to share, then they have to crop, they have to find a way how to tweet it, what to do with it. We created standard formats which went through the paper, which are very easy for people to just click and tweet. Similarly, in the e-paper, you will find that these social cards in the next 3 days will become tweetable. So you can actually, when you are looking at an e-paper, you want to tweet something right from the paper, you can do that from there, or you can share it on Facebook, or you can share it on Instagram. So it becomes a very, very shareable kind of proposition. What you see below that are a set of icons. And what you see embedded in the stories are QR codes. So every story which has got something else that people should know about is addressed with a QR code. These QR codes actually take you either to another part of the story which is related or in-depth part of that story, or would take you to a video, or would take you to a podcast, or would take you to a graphic. But the whole idea is that there is more to it that you can kind of engage with. And not just engage with, actually we call it experiencing, engaging, and expressing. So you can share it with people, you can express yourself, you can express your views. Also, we have here what you see on the top right. You see here, you know, formats which are Instagrammable. I mean, so you can actually just click this and you can put it in Insta, because these have all been created as page one plus. It actually captures all the stories that cannot come on page one, but are important stories for you to kind of look at on page two. And then you see a whole lot of infographics that have come into play. We've also got HT in 5 minutes. So all the stories that you should be reading, and you don't want to get that feeling of FOMO. Keep going. I will just finish it in 2 minutes. Keep going, please. Some other aspects, but I'll skip that. Let me just come to HT Weekend. This Sunday, by the way, you must get hold of your copy of Hindustan Times if you really want to see what a weekend newspaper looks like. And this again is full of stuff which is going to be, catering to the millennials on news they can use, pieces on culture, lifestyle, gadgetry, and much more. So that's the new Weekend. And as you can see, this button and the Weekend branding is very, today is very millennial in the way it has been crafted, including the design and content. Keep going, please. Obviously, we also have the entire HT City totally revamped, and check it out on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. You will get to see some new destinations and amazing new way of presentation, which is digitally, as I said, completely digitally integrated. Go forward. The brunch actually changes completely because of the millennials, the influencers and the role models suddenly change and they become far younger. So what you see is a lot of social cards here in different colors and forms, which means a lot of different influencers that you can just click and tweet. You can also see short social cards here right in the middle, and various content forms which are going to be changing completely. Go forward, please. Needless to say, the entire portfolio is revamped. The only other highlight I would say is that while schools are closed, we're going to bring a version, which is an e-paper version for school kids, which is going to be specially crafted for them. And as you can see, this front page looks very different from the front page of the main Hindustan Times. Go forward, please. I'm almost done. Already talked about the digital integrations. Keep going. Obviously, all of this translates into our digital product, which has been launched now, and it is in two phases. The final avatar of this actually finally comes up in January, but this is the first of the block in terms of the repurposed and redesigned digital platform. Please, you go forward. I'm pretty much done. I think the last message that I would leave is that for us at Hindustan Times, a newspaper, maybe a business, but Hindustan Times has been a crusade, as put by Dr. K.K. Birla. I just now request to play a short film, which you guys can take a look at, which is all about, as I said, what Anuja said earlier, genuineness and credibility of the brand. Go ahead, please.
It's a human thing to want the truth. It doesn't matter if you're older or part of the youth. We certainly don't like being kept in the dark between all those lies and those question marks. But lately, it doesn't seem to bother us when they bend and break and twist and crush the truth that's supposed to matter so much. In the race to be the first who breaks the news, they seem to have broken the news. And do you even remember the time when the news was supposed to make you wise? And now you can spend hours consuming and listening them shouting and complaining, and in the end, just feeling worse off than you did in the beginning. Which begs the question, does all of this not trouble our generation? When they push opinions and call them facts as we watch the fourth pillar crumble and collapse. It is a human thing to want the truth and to make every claim carry its burden of proof. To expect that the first voice you hear is also the last word that's there.
Meet the all-new Hindustan Times. Now experience, engage and express. Hindustan Times. First voice, last word.
I wish technology allowed us to present it better, but that's okay. You would have got a feel for it.
You can still applaud this fantastic.
Thank you.
A nice video, Rajan.
Thank you. Thank you.
And we can't wait to get hold of that Weekend Sunday HT, like yes. You mentioned. Okay, time for some questions. I'm just taking the liberty to club a couple of them. So there's one from Tanishka to Rajiv. She says, of course, distribution lack of, you know, proper distribution could have would have impacted sales and thus revenue. How did HT counter that? And do you see the festival season changing that for you? Do you expect a huge turnaround due because of the IPL and the festive season?
Yeah. So look, yes, revenues have certainly been impacted as they have been for most mediums and publications alike. So we have in this period, therefore, been working more on the fundamentals, basics of Rajan mentioned earlier about on educating on the safety of the newspapers, which we did. And then separately, parallelly, in the last 2 to 3 months, we have been doing lots of work on at the ground level on building back distribution and circulation across the country. And it's an industry thing. And thankfully, the entire industry is working together on this, you know, flight of vendors to their hometowns, labor. So several industries have been impacted by this. So that's what we've been working on. And thankfully, it has all stood us in good stead as well. And we are hoping that as marketeers start reinvesting in advertising and, you know, building their brands and promoting sales, we will also be the beneficiaries of that. So that's what by and large we've been doing. Interestingly, in the last 4, 5, 6 months, I must say we've also got calls from several and actually more consumer goods organizations to actually partner with them on distribution as well, because I'm you know, one of my very close friends who heads an FMCG organization, they were also struggling with the distribution woes, labors, unloaders, loaders. And so actually in several cities, we have actually helped partner some of these organizations with our vendor network to be able to do that. So all of these are the various kinds of things that we've been doing last 3, 4, 5 months. And as I said, I'm pleased to see that some of those are bearing fruit. And especially in the Hindi part, we are as good as normal in our distribution. English, still there is some way to go. More so cities like Mumbai, Pune, and some of those cities are a little more impacted at this point in time, although improving. But pleased with what we have accomplished so far.
Neeta, while they say in this business world, hope should not be a strategy, but sometimes it is. So in the COVID times, how the festive pans out.
Absolutely.
No, we are very, very keen that all our all the industries, everybody does very well. Sales go through the roof, and therefore they all start reinvesting. Because at the end of the day, we are, you know, ANP is the first line that takes a hit in most organizations. So we are pretty much at the receiving end of what most industries are going through: automobiles, real estate, several industries. In fact, it's not good to see some of these industries struggling as well. And we are fervently hoping that, you know, things get back to normalcy soon.
I think we have time for one more. I think this one is addressed to you, Anil. Do you think the shift from print to digital in terms of content consumption is because periodicity is getting replaced by immediacy?
Yeah, I think something that we spoke about in the webinar as well at length. I think it's not about periodicity getting replaced by immediacy, but getting complemented by it. And hence the coexistence of both. I think the interesting point, again, I go back to the fact that, you know, old timers like us remember this whole notion of letters to the editor. Imagine the new age version of it. That's the immediacy of response that the digital medium can bring in, right? So I think that's the complementarity of these mediums that makes each of them so unique, and definitely see the potential of them to coexist seamlessly.
I'm just interrupting. Just one line that I wanted to add was that also the other thing we have tried to do in this period is that we have integrated the market-facing, customer-facing organization, the digital organization and the print organization in order to be able to create and customize a package solution for most advertisers, which we thought is also important now, more so now with all that is happening around us. So that's the other thing we've been doing last 3, 4 months, and that's also stood us in good stead.
Okay, I think we'll take one more question. This one is interesting. This is addressed to Vikram and Rana. You know, it says, it's by Sneha, and she wants to know, while legacy brands like HT have caught on to the pulse of both their consumers and customers, advertisers who are happy to explore their integrated offering When will we see agencies also buy that in a consolidated, integrated fashion, rather than looking at print, digital, and silos?
Well, we would like to believe that we have integrated offerings. So, well, maybe we can't satisfy everybody, but I think, but that is definitely the endeavor. So right now, in fact, most agencies have got their entire planning philosophy is a very integrated journey planning, the entire marketing funnel, integration of the marketing funnel, however you want to describe it. All of us talk that language and all of us have got some very, very advanced tools and systems which actually allow us to even measure the impact of cross media. So I would say that our attempt is there to actually do all of that. And we, in fact, when we talk to media owners, that's exactly the language we speak.
So yeah, that's true.
Well, Sneha, if you're a client, I need to speak to you. If you're a media owner, I think we need to speak even more.
No, yeah, that's true. Actually, you know, absolutely, it's a you know, self-defeating purpose if you try to do it the other way around. So it's absolutely clear that its approach is totally integrated, and it's very clear because we understand which mediums are working well. So it's, we don't keep it in silos anymore. Those days are gone.
Okay, fantastic. Any last thoughts before we wind up?
No, Nita, you should have the first voice and the last word.
I got it. That's super. Rajan, I got to have a chat. I got to have a chat with you to understand how to get this right every time. You got it right.
Rajan was desperately looking for an opportunity. You gave him one. So
I know.
Fantastic. So I shall have the last word then. So like Rajan said, hope is a very important thing. Here's looking forward to a great festive season for print and digital both, and literally putting the very dismal Q2 behind all of us in the true sense of the term. So thank you so much to all the panelists for a very, very enlightening discussion. And we are all looking forward to reading more of HT. thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Nita. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.